Welcome to the Black Lesbian Archives opening reception. This is the first Black Lesbian Archives tour event of 2019, and I'm just like, what? It's like crazy, it's full circle. When I actually first started the Black Lesbian Archives, after talking to Tracy, Gerber Hart's library and archives was the first place that she was like, you need to go, this is where you need to be, you need to talk to Will. So we're here now. Will has definitely been a number one supporter in the Black Lesbian Archives. The space, the food, the drinks, the vibe is all Will. So, you know, before you leave, please say thank you, or you did your thing, Will. See you. Shout out to Will for giving me more than 2 hours of time to put this together, even though I said 2 hours, it ended up being six.
Yeah, I'm Will Brandt. I'm the director here at the Gerber Library. I want to welcome you all to this space. Thank you for including us in all this. Yeah, usually when you tell me time, I multiply times three. When you said that you left earlier today, you said, I'm going to be back at one. It's like maybe four or five. That's what you mean.
Exactly.
But anyways, hopefully, after looking through stuff here, we have stuff from Gerber Hart's collection back on the back table there. Good display that group put together. Some of you have already seen the exhibit that we have on drag in Chicago, City That Works. We have other exhibits coming up. One on the sports dykes and girl jocks in March. And another one on the gay liberation movement in June in Chicago. So if you want to know more about what's happening with us, there's a sign-up sheet at the back for the Gerber Hart newsletter. You'll get to know what all we're happening and what we're doing. Thanks.
Perfect. All right, so how the Black Lesbian Archives got started real quick. I was in Williamsburg, Virginia at the time, and I was sitting by the lake, and I was thinking to myself, I'm like, okay, we're finally here. We're finally coming into our Black Lesbianism. Like, it's here. Like, I identified as a lesbian, but I wasn't like openly, like with the cape and everything. so it took me some time. The web series that I was looking into, it just no longer sufficed. I was like, this is getting old. And I'm a history nerd. Like, I love history. I love researching times and things like that. So I was online and I was like, Black Lesbian Archives, Black Lesbian. Yeah, it wasn't a lot there. So I was like, well, you know what that means? So hey, we're here. I'm all about solutions. And, you know, Black Lesbian, the community is like very, very, very dear to me. So I went in like that same day. I started an Instagram, had a website. Like, I was reaching out to people like, do you have this here? Like, could you donate this here? Like, where are we at? You know what I mean? So the Black Lesbian Archives is really a way to bring visibility to the Black lesbians in the community because we aren't really visible. I went to, I know a lot of y'all know Kristen Kaza, Slomo, all of that. Went to Kristen Kaza's Lost and Found. It was an exhibit, I think, October 27, 2018, I think, is when I first moved to Chicago. And I fell in love, and I was just like, this exhibit is amazing. So it just kind of kickstarted everything. The exhibit was from June to July at Affinity Community Services, and incredible. So now we're here. So I appreciate y'all for coming through. I appreciate y'all for y'all's support and coming through in the pouring rain. It's crazy out here. So updates for the tour. We have March 3rd, I'll be at the Irish American Heritage Center. From like 1 to 5. Yeah, I'll be there from like 1 to 5. So if you wanna come there, updates for the tour, just put your name down over there on the paper and then I'll send y'all like the updates and how you can subscribe and stuff like that. If you would like to donate archives or you know somebody who would like to donate archives, interviews, funds, anything like that, I'll leave my information is over there. So if you know somebody or if you want to bring the archives to you, the information is over there as well. I'm down to go anywhere in Chicago, let me know, we will be there. Okay, and I think that's about it. Now we are gonna get to the nitty gritty. Rachel Pierce, would you like to come up here, Rachel? Come up here. Y'all give a round of applause for Rachel, let's say. Outside of Chicago. Rachel is committed to the work of growing the visibility of queer POC on screen and in church leadership. Black Queer Her Story, Chicago is a collection of video journals and short films of the Black LGBT women from Chicago who have participated in the life over the past decades. Chicago is known for being progressive LGBTQ history. However, the stories of Black women who contributed to that history are regularly overlooked. BQHC is a film series about visibility, celebration, and education for the present and next generation to come. So once again, y'all give it up for Rachel Pierce.
Well, good evening, everybody. Again, my name is Rachel Pierce. I am a filmmaker. I'm not gonna say I'm inspiring or I'm trying to be, I am one. just a little background about myself. I'm from the South Side of Chicago. I come from the village of Calumet Park. It's like a little village on the outskirts of Chicago. Knew I was same gender loving from a young age, but growing up in the Pentecostal church, there wasn't very much space for me to explore that. And like I would assume many young people, and thankfully with the internet, would just be Googling on my flip phone, like gay Chicago, queer, something. But all there really was the L word. Yeah. I didn't really have any people of color, you know, after Ellen.com, but again, mostly white contributors. And just the sense of belonging. Like, yes, I'm gay, I'm a lesbian, but where's the Black history and all of this? And so trying to figure that out, being younger and even now thinking, okay, we have more resources, we have more technology, but still, like, where's the story? And just like Cruz saying, like, we have to be our own curators of the story, we have to bring these stories to In doing that, I was like, okay, well, let's do Black History Chicago. And so I manage a cab company, M&A Leasing. I manage about 200 yellow cabs. I don't find much, I have a good job. My bosses are good to me, but it's not super fulfilling. So I was like, yeah, let me try this filmmaking thing. So my first project about it would be Black Queer History Chicago. And yeah, so what this story is basically footage from the documentary. I'm hoping to have it released February of next year. And just about how Black women have contributed since pre-Stonewall, from the Great Migration to present day, to Black culture, to lesbian inclusion in the gay movement, and just all the different issues, adoption, the AIDS epidemic, gay marriage. And how I was wanting to shape this, though, was like through a faith lens. And that's how I'm framing this. The two women that you'll see tonight will be Elvie Mayfield. She's one of my buddies from church. She's been born and raised in Chicago, closeted for the most part, but after finding an inclusive church, found more liberation to come out and be who she is. And then also we have Pat McCombs. A lot of you have heard of the legend Pat McCombs, activist, promoter, organizer, co-founder pretty much of Executive Suite, and just doing a lot for our community today. So well, that's pretty much it for now. So thank you guys for being here. I really appreciate it. And here's some footage from Black Queer History Chicago.
My name is L.B. Mayfield, formerly known as Lavera Helena Wilson. I've been an accountant for 30 years, but currently I am following my passion also. So I'm doing personal training and wellness, trying to figure out a way to impact our community a little bit more in regards to the type 2 diabetes crisis, as well as chronic illness that's occurring throughout the country.
Well, my name is Patricia McCombs. I was born in 1949. And I've been in Chicago all my life. I think I'm mostly well known for the parties that I give, the social outlets for women of color.
So my first church was Haven Rest Missionary Baptist Church, 79th and Stony Island, where John Connor was my pastor. And I love that dude. I always thought he was like a father that I never had. Haven of Rest is where I really, really found out who Jesus was.
Well, I was raised in a Baptist church. Church by the name of Christian Tabernacle Baptist Church, Reverend Maxwell Lewis, on the south side of Chicago, 47th and Prairie, as a matter of fact. That was our social outlet, spiritual, it was everything. I did Bible class, I was on a nursing board, I was in the choir, I was an ursa.
You be in church from morning till the night, you know? And so that's how I grew up and got to church. I was glad for church because I think I had a lot of anger about a lot of things. And when I started going to church and reading the Bible and being in that environment, I stopped being so mean and like just mad about stuff all the time. I was breaking stuff and fighting every day. My mom was like, hey, do you need help or something? What is wrong with you? But I think I was also struggling internally with who I am. You know, I didn't know what the feelings I was having were, but I was having them. But I knew at church, you know, that's not right. So it was like, put that up, because that's not right. And I started to just focus on the church. Focus on the church.
Well, I was in the closet in the church most of the time, most of my life. I didn't feel comfortable coming out in terms of my sexuality because I didn't think that the church frowned upon that, even though it was filled up with a lot of gay people who were active in all aspects of the church, the choir, the Sunday school, the nursing board, everybody. There was somebody gay on all the boards in the church, but you had to keep it like undercover because people would ridicule you. I felt very uncomfortable in that aspect.
With Reverend Connor and the way that the church was, it just was not, every time they spoke about homosexuality, it was like the worst thing you could ever be or do. When he would preach about the gays, I always felt he struggled. Because when he would preach about the gays and he would talk about sissies and this, he would always say, which always stuck in my head, I'm not just talking to you, I'm talking to me.
So coming out is really, it's important, but it's scary. It's a lot of fear with coming out.
When I turned 23, I was out of my brother's house and everything, and I kind of decided, okay, I'm gonna be who I am. And I was keeping it undercover. I still wasn't telling anybody that I was going out to the club and stuff. And I probably still wouldn't have told for a long, long time, except that my sister busted me kissing a girl. I dropped her off, she left her, and the cop came back to get her, and I was kissing. She told my mother. So now my mother has her ears pierced because of me, because she was so upset and on the floor crying and wailing to the Lord that I was gay. She was numb, she said. She wouldn't have her ears pierced. And she just didn't even feel it.
I think once I came out to my mother and I let her know that I was a lesbian, she didn't like it. But she didn't say you gotta leave the house, you gotta do this, you gotta do that. She just loved her children and she just, my father never said a word. And after that, I told her, look, I'm a good daughter, I'm not pregnant, I'm in school. Whatever work I do, I give you my check, so hey, this is me. And I told her, look, you're supposed to be a Christian woman, Christians supposed to love all people. And she just accepted me for who I was.
It's still crazy. I ain't gonna lie. I can't be in here talking about, oh yeah, it's easy for me now. I have it all together. No, my family and I are kind of estranged a lot of times because they don't accept my relationship.
When I decided to do parties, I tried to incorporate a few things related to women's issues, or I might have somebody come and speak. I didn't push it, so to speak. I approached it from a social aspect, and I didn't throw it in their face like, you gotta do this, you gotta do that. I just let them know what was out there.
I think that having an opportunity to find space that helped me understand more that I'm not a mistake. And that God made me who I am, just how I am, and that he knew me before the foundation of the world. Every time I read that scripture, I feel like he knew me. He said, before I was a thought in your eye, or in your eye, before you thought, because he already knew when, and he knew who I was. He knew everything before it even happened. He already knows a plan and it's it. I just gotta stop.
People get together through partying and eating and talking among ourselves, sitting in the kitchen. You can get people to talk about different views and their feelings about certain things, sitting in the kitchen at the table. And I like to think of us together, sitting in the kitchen at the table. You can get so many ideas and you can get a feeling of where people are coming from, sitting at a kitchen table, sitting around eating, partying, you know.
Thank you for that. Yep. Another round of applause. Like, she's, if y'all never met Pat, before you leave this earth, please just have one conversation with Pat McCombs, and it'll change your whole life. Thank you so much. Let's go ahead and get into these questions. I got a couple questions that I want to ask. Some on the film, some just a little bit about you. First off, because you know I gotta do it, about you, zodiac sign. And happy Pisces season, by the way. Is there any Pisces in the building? By raising hands, is there any Pisces? No Pisces? There's no Pisces, like no, for real. Wow, that's wild. Okay, let's go ahead and get into it. Did you grow up in Chicago, and how was that like for you? Like, were you born and raised in Chicago?
So I'm a Leo. I'm a July Leo, July 24th. I'm from the south side of Chicago, from Calumet Park, born and raised. I've only spent, I guess, maybe 2 years outside of Chicago, after graduating high school, trying to find myself or whatever. But made it back home, and I've been here ever since.
Okay,
yeah.
Cool. Well, welcome home. how and when did you start to come and embrace your sexuality, and what was that time like for you? Like, what was going through your head, like, when you were like, oh, this is it.
I'd say probably when I knew it was, like, for real, that I was same gender loving, was when I was a freshman in high school. I would say going to, like, summer basketball camp and stuff, and just, like, girls everywhere and stuff. I'm like, oh, she's cute. Oh, she's so cool. And just, I think that's when I started thinking about it. And then also, I would say, I think Queer as Folk was on back then. And so I used to watch that show and be like, that's what that is. Or, but they didn't have much lesbian representation, actually.
Besides the homework. Yeah, definitely. How was your religion, faith? Like, what kind of role did that play in your life growing up? Like, were you initially, is it something that you chose? Was it like, was your family, did they bring you? How did that work out?
Yeah, so I was born into the Pentecostal church. I went to private Christian school up until high school, and that's when I went to public school. And yeah, I was taught it's Adam and Eve, not Adam and Steve. And yeah, like a lot of people that I'll interview or talk to, sometimes, you know, we'll talk about things like church hurt. And I never really experienced, it may be because I was young and naive, but much like hypocrisy in the church, like, oh, they're hypocritical or whatever. I never really experienced that. I always had a great fondness and hunger for church, for the presence of God in my life. So yeah, it was difficult once going to high school and like having the space to explore, but knowing like, I can't have these conversations back at church. I can't have these conversations about how I'm feeling back at home. And then feeling that internalized homophobia, well, I can't even talk about this with my friends like at school. And so it just became this, starting to live this double life, which caused a lot of, you know, harm and trauma to me, and also ended up hurting people that I very much cared about. You know, from like just not being who I am, you know, but trying to be somebody that I think somebody else will like, and not being true to myself. And so yeah, but still like always having my faith and feeling like God loved me, but I didn't know like why or how, because I didn't see that in scripture. And yeah, it took a long time. Like I said, after high school, I left for a couple of years. But when I came back to Chicago, getting my life together or whatever, I felt very blessed and fortunate and thankful to my ancestors for the prayers prayed up for me, and just feeling like, you know, I need to show some type of gratitude. And for me, like, gratitude is like, go back to church, you know? And so when I found Urban Village and they said they were like open and affirming, you know, welcoming, you know, I didn't believe it, but I tried it. And then over time I realized that they want me. And once I was able to like kind of let down that wall and be vulnerable, like that's when the transformation really started happening in my life, as far as like reconciling that and being my whole self 100% of the time. That's what I try to do.
That's love, definitely.
Yeah.
What inspired the film?
film, like when you first thought about putting the film together, like what was the first thing that went through your mind when you started it? And also, what is your overall vision of this work? Like, where do you see this going in the future?
Well, I'd say like there's a growing movement as far as like build visibility, you know, visibility in the workforce for women, Black women, visibility in the media, and also just positions, right? Positions of leadership. That's what we're wanting. And women have basically like built this country, have built and supported like a lot of the different institutions that we're a part of, but never really get credit for it. And just knowing that is really what just inspired me to like, okay, well, this Black queer history that we have in Chicago, like what are their stories? What was their process and journey like as a woman, as a Black woman, and as a Black queer woman, and how those particular things affected and shaped and, you know, had a lot to do with how they were able to walk in this life, and just wanting to honor that history was basically the inspiration, I'd say.
Storytelling is so powerful, you know, just sitting with somebody and just listening to what they've been through, like how they navigate, and things like that. It really helps you relate. You know what I'm saying? Like, we go through so many different things on a daily basis, but when you sit and talk to somebody without, like, just that rawness, you know what I mean? Like, I feel you, like, I see you, you know what I mean? Like, what is this? Like, what does this all really mean at the end of the day? Like, yeah, that's a whole other conversation.
Right, and I just, what I would say, what I would hope for this, not just this film, but this movement, is just for people to know, like, you belong. You know, there's space for you, there's room for you, as Pat said, at the table, you know, and just for those that feel called or have gifts to create communities or have access to resources, to just to help people know they have room at the table, you know.
Fix you a plate, girl.
You might not taste that good.
Right, but you're at the table though, right?
So, what's one thing that you wish that you knew then that you know now?
I'd say that I belong. You know, that I belong, that I'm not alone in my experience, past experience or future experiences, you know, but I don't really know that unless I have the time to like build authentic relationships and have those vulnerable conversations, you know, to really know and like accept and believe that you're not alone.
Upcoming events, where can we find you? Where are you at? Where are you located?
Yeah, so you can find me at church. Hyde Park, Woodlawn. We meet at the Chicago Theological Seminary on 60th and Dorchester. We're there 10:30 a.m. on Sunday. It's about 45 minutes. We eat food afterwards. It's good fellowship time together. Also, I'm on Facebook. Rachel Pierce, my company, Pie 360 Co. You can catch me on that page, and then also I have Instagram that I can shoot out to you guys.
What's the Instagram name?
It's Rach, R-A-C-H underscore P-I dot media. That's my Instagram, it's kind of long.
Perfect. Well, I would like to open this part up, the section up, to any questions that you may have. I will pass the mic so you can sit at the table. anybody have any questions or comments, concerns, or anything? So, gotcha. And your name is Odia.
Hi, I'm Chris. I'm Aries, March Aries.
Hey!
And my question would be, what kind of ideas...
Close, a little bit closer to the mic.
My question would be, what kind of ideas inspired the interview, the questions, the conversations that you had with these people in your film?
That's a good question. Honestly, most of the women that I've come in contact to and have been willing to share their stories, like, I don't know them. All I know is basically like what I've read in like Black Lines, or hearing people tell stories or urban legends and things like that. And so my process has been, and I'm always thinking, how can I perfect my process? Because it's a lot. It's really just sitting down and like having dinner or lunch with the women and just saying like, what is it that you'd like to share about your story? Like I tell them my heart and what I'm trying to do with this project. And then based off like what they've shared to me, like in that personal space, I'll come up with questions that kind of like will dig in more into, you know, the different things that they want to tell as far as like their coming out story. Some women feel very strong led to talk about domestic violence within the lesbian community. So things like that. I would say definitely coming in with the story that I want to tell as far as coming out and the importance of it for those behind us, you know, for, so they know that they're here, that, you know, it's liberating the things that you're able to accomplish once you kind of like let that fear go, but then also being sensitive and honoring the experience of some people, they just can't, you know, because of where they're at. But yeah, definitely having dinner, talking with women, what do they want to share, and then try to shape my questions from what I'm trying to do to, you know, kind of get the answers.
Thank you.
Hello, I'm Alicia. I'm a July Leo.
Hey!
My birthday is July 23rd. I'm trying to figure out how to phrase it. So I see a lot of like different ways that people have built community, not only here, but in your work. And I'm wondering how, like a lot of these people are like building community in communities they were born and raised in, right? So how do folks who are like, say new to Chicago and are Black, I'm not saying that's me, I've been here like 13 years, but for those who haven't been here for that long, what are some ways that you see them being able to be a part of like a Black queer community or a Black lesbian community in Chicago or maybe elsewhere?
I'm not from here. Oh, yeah. I'm actually not from here at all. Like I moved to Chicago, here 4 years, so that was 17. Was that 17? Yeah, 17, August 17. I was actually a transplant from, I'm born in Texas, but I came here from Williamsburg, Virginia. Before that, I was in Atlanta, Georgia, like, you know.
I grew up in Richmond.
Hey, ooh! We gotta talk. We definitely gotta talk. Before I got to Chicago, I was in Richmond.
Yeah.
And it was lit. First Fridays?
Yeah.
Okay. Okay, let's get back. Yeah, Richmond. If y'all ever get a chance to go to Virginia, go to Richmond. I promise you, it'll change your life. Like, it's like South by Southwest on crack. But it's like home base. Like, when South by Southwest first started, it's amazing. The music. Okay, back to it. Basically, I came and I realized there was a need for something. It's something I'm passionate about, something that I identify with, something that's all me. And this is the stuff that I love to do, so I just made it happen. Like, you know what I mean? Like, and then in that process of making things happen, making productions, you know what I mean? Like, you find people in that same tribe that are like, hey, I like to do this stuff too. Let's tango. Like, what's up? Like, what's good? Like, what would you like to contribute? Like, do you want to do, like, what do you want to do? Like, let's make it happen. So I think for me, the newness, because that's something that I struggle with, especially I was talking to Imani about that when I first got here. I was like, well, I'm new here. Like, what, you know what I'm saying? Like, people going to be looking at me like, girl, you ain't even from here. Like, what you trying to do? You know what I mean? Like, what? But it was the passion, it was the fire inside me that was like, but we need this stuff. Like, regardless of me just being like a newbie here, just a newcomer or whatever like that, this is something we need. And like I said, in that process, you'll find people who eventually want to do stuff. So I mean, if you want to be down with the team, you know what I mean, and come through for the Black Lesbian Archive, we can definitely talk, for sure.
We'll talk after.
Okay, for sure, Richmond.
Yeah, for sure. Like what Chris saying is just, I think Charlene Carruthers said like this thing about self-determination, of kind of like putting yourself in those spaces that you want to be a part of that reflect your values and how you go about things. And those might not necessarily, like I go on Meetup, I'm like, oh, I need like, I'm going through a midlife crisis, I need a midlife, like early life crisis. So like go on Meetup, find out like a photography club or a nature walking club or something like that. And like you'll, when you find and do things that you enjoy doing, you'll meet queer folk, you know, in those spaces and you know, make friends, build a chart, I don't know, you know? So yeah, just keep putting yourself out there, you know, for sure. And
that's how we met, actually.
Yeah, just showing up, you know?
Yeah, like, came to one of the exhibits.
I went by myself.
Right, and she's like, yo, I like what you're doing. I was like, I like what you're doing too, let's tango, like, let's do it, let's make it happen. Like, don't think about limitations, just think of what could be, like, what you could start just right now with the resources that you have.
Yeah, I mean, I could ask questions for days, but I want to hear other people too.
Anybody else? Y'all good? Okay.
My name is Timothy, and I'm a Capricorn.
Hey.
So I'm real serious.
The whole talk there.
But yeah, I have a question for you because I grew up in a Protestant church that was not affirming, and you know, sort of like dealt with all of the BS that I had about that before coming out. And that probably didn't sound right, but what I'm trying to say is I left the church before I came out for reasons that were personal in my own belief system, and found something that works for me. But a couple of years ago, I attended the Reformation Project, and you and I with Urban Village probably have some of the same friends.
What's the Reformation Project?
Yeah. Is that better?
Yeah.
Okay. So the Reformation Project. My main question is: are you connected with them? And then, do you want to be? Because we probably have some similar like groups of friends that we connect with already. And I think that this your film project would be something that they would be interested in. I mean, I can't speak for them, but if you already know, you can tell her about the Reformation Project, or I can too.
Yeah, so the Reformation Project, I've heard of them. I'm subscribed to their newsletters and see them a lot at the different conferences that I attend. From what I know, they're like a Methodist. They're doing work to work for full inclusion of LGBT clergy. In the Methodist denomination, and actually right now the United Methodist Church is having a general conference where they're having talks on this discussion about how to address sexuality within the church. And it's something that's really tough, and it might split them up, and we're just praying to see how that goes. But to answer your question, I'm not directly affiliated with them. I know a lot of people. I don't know if you know Jarrell Wilson.
Yeah,
he like spoke and like when they were here.
Yeah.
He's great.
Insane.
And what I admire about them is being a network out there that bring us queer Christians together and are actually doing work to bring about inclusion. But if you'd like to connect, I'd appreciate that for sure.
Yeah, that'd be great. So that was really important for me, even though it wasn't like something that I needed with my like to reconcile with my belief system, but it was really important that I saw, oh, there are queer Christians out there that actually still want to be involved in church and stuff, which is totally new for me.
Yeah, and definitely what I've come to find being an out queer Christian is like our theologies are so different. Like even within that, like, you know, some people believe Jesus is the way, some people don't think Jesus is the way. You know, the sense of like, every God is like the same God. And even with us, like we just have to be super careful of like not excluding each other. You know what I'm saying? Like we all have room at the table. You know what I'm saying? Like we get kicked out of the church, now I'm gonna kick you out because you have a different, like no, like that's not how this is gonna work. That's not how it's made to work.
Yeah.
actually about the same trace of religion. I was trying to figure the question out. Oops, flyer.
What's your name?
All science. Wink, wink. Sagittarius.
Okay.
Oh, whoa, what's the reaction? Okay, I guess the question I was trying to form was along the lines of, how have you formed a new relationship with God and just grappling with a new way, because you did say different theologies, and other Christians would argue that it's not Christian, and I grew up in a very pious family, and that was definitely a very upheld way of living, is to be religious and pursue God and pursue that way of belief. And obviously, for me, me being gay and coming out was very difficult, as it was for many other people who come from religious backgrounds and non-religious too. For example, I have a sister who is pursuing ministry, and when I first came out, she was extremely open about me being gay, and only until like 1 year ago about that she, even still having her pursued ministry at the time, she was still very, but God loves all, you're more than welcome, like very warm and friendly about it, and now it's like a total 180 again, so, or not again, but now it is. And so I guess you having found a new community that has a different theology, do you feel that, or how are you living now as a person? And even in your artwork too, maybe, but how have you recommitted to God? Has it been easy? What's it like? What's it like now, having that new community? Sorry for the very long question.
Mm-hmm. Oh, I can chime in, it's all good.
I'd say for myself, it's a new experience every day. Like I said earlier, I was born and raised in the Pentecostal church. I didn't realize growing up that Pentecostals were a minority, like in the church, you know? So when I'm talking to my, you know, queer Christian friends, I talk about, oh, the Holy Spirit, and I feel the Lord speaking to me. They're like, you crazy, what are you talking about, you know? And I grieve that sometimes, right? Because it's like I want to experience and have those emotions and feelings that I would have in the church growing up and stuff, and honestly, like, in service, it's not always like that. But still, being in a space where we're all welcomed and we're all working towards being intentional of living out the gospel, like, with each other, of sharing love, or letting people know that, like, at our church, like, everybody's welcome to communion, you know, whether you're an atheist, whatever, like, you're, like, we want you to take the bread and drink the cup, you know? And it's been challenging because, like a lot of different theologies come in and, like, we can, like, you know, butt heads. Like, recently I went to this conference, the Q Christian Fellowship Conference, and that was the first time I learned about what side A and side B is. Like, side A is something where, you know, it's same gender, sex affirming, and, you know, inclusive in that way. But then side B is like, yeah, you're gay, but don't act out on your feelings and stuff. And, like, having space where it's like you honor those different beliefs, but not saying, like, yeah, you have to believe it, or you have it. Like, you know, we don't want to, what's really right and what's wrong? Who knows, you know? But what I know is what has brought me life to my path, right? And it's been being in community. It's been in constant search of, like, God. Not just like, God, where are you? But, like, God within people, right? And how can I connect in that way? But then also, how do I get there? It's like finding the right resources, right? A lot of people say, like, you know, you feel excluded from the church because of bad theology, right? Well, what's good theology? Let me read some of that, you know? And I feel like the Lord gives us the space, gives us the choice, right, to figure out how we're going to do things and stuff. And I feel like if you're just faithfully trying to do good and be the best person that, you know, you were put on here to be, like, I mean, I think that's why Christ came, so we could experience that. Did I answer your question?
Yeah.
All right, okay.
I'm just going to make a comment. So I am Latanya, August Virgo.
So
August Virgo, yes. We're the best Virgos. Yeah, we're not so rigid, right? But I just want to make a comment how amazing it is that you're bringing spirituality to our communities. You know, I also grew up Kojic, I'm assuming that's what you were. And there are a lot of things I really liked about church. And I think, you know, I the reason why I left the church is because they told me I had to wear a dress while I was playing outside, which boys didn't have to do that. And so why did the girls have to dress up? And so I was just like really angry for years. And you know, it's really, I love how you're doing this because there's a lot of health that comes with spirituality, and I think in our communities there's a lot of unhealthy behaviors, and I think being able to make this okay, that, you know, you can explore, and you know, a lot of people don't because they feel like they're condemned, you know, and so this is like a really positive thing that I see coming in our communities and appearing more. And it doesn't have to be Christian, it can be anything, but it's you know, just in my own, you know, with my partner, and, you know, we're both pretty spiritual, we're not Christians, but just the health of your relationship is so much better and different, and it's having different dimensions, and a lot of queer people just don't explore that. And I almost didn't explore it because of what had happened before, so I really appreciate you making that movie as well. I think people seeing that, you know, sometimes parents have a complicated way of dealing with it, but they still affirm themselves and be happy and, you know, create their own community. So thank you. I just wanted to comment on that, and I really enjoyed the film. So.
Thank you so much.
Anybody else? Yeah.